Hello everyone, I am Deep Patel from the Department of Mechanical Engineering. As you all know, we were discussing about the chapter number 4, that is properties of steam. And in the properties of steam, we have discussed about main two topic. First is the steam generation, and second we have discussed about some equations and the definitions. Like in the last lecture, we have discussed about the what is the meaning of enthalpy, which are the types of steam is available, like wet steam, dry steam and the superheated steam. We said that in the wet steam there is a mixture of water particles and the steam particles. In the dry steam we have 100% steam, and in the superheated steam the steam from the dry state it will again heated and then it will reach to the superheated state. That steam is known as the superheated steam. Okay, then we have discussed about the internal energy and its equations and the specific volume for the different conditions, like wet condition, dry condition and the superheated condition. Okay, so we have discussed all these equations. So today in this lecture we are going to discuss about how the dryness fraction is calculated. Okay, we know that what is the meaning of dryness fraction. Dryness fraction is the fraction through which we can understand how much percentage of the steam is available in the total mixture of wet steam. Okay, so we have discussed that the dryness fraction is denoted by the x, and the equation of dryness fraction is ms upon mw plus ms. Okay, so we said that if the value of dryness fraction is 0.5, that means if 1 kilogram of wet steam available, in which 500 ml will be steam and 500 ml will be water. If the value of dryness fraction is 0.3, then in 1 kilogram of wet steam, 300 ml of steam and remaining 700 ml of water will be available. So with the help of dryness fraction, we can understand that how much amount of steam is present in entire wet steam. Okay, so today we will discuss about the calorimeters. Now, what is the calorimeter? Okay, so the calorimeter is the device through which we can measure the dryness fraction of the wet steam. Okay, so there are total 4 calorimeters through which we can measure the dryness fraction. So in this lecture we will understand 2 basic calorimeters to measure the dryness fraction. First is the barrel calorimeter and second is the throttling calorimeter. Okay, so first of all, let us start with the barrel calorimeter. Sometimes this barrel calorimeter is also known as the bucket calorimeter. Okay, so first of all, see this diagram. In this diagram you can see there are many components. So one by one we are going to understand what is the component and what is its function. Okay, so let us begin with the first main steam pipe. So the main steam pipe is connected with the boiler. We know that boiler is used to produce the steam. Then we use this steam to run the turbine, and ultimately the turbine will rotate and it will produce the electricity. Okay, so the main steam pipe is connects with the boiler. Okay, so through boiler we are going to supply the steam. Now here our function, our main aim is to measure the dryness fraction of the steam. Now we know that dryness fraction of the water at saturation condition is 0, and dryness fraction of dry steam at saturation condition is equals to 1. Okay, so that the dryness fraction of wet steam will be vary between 0 to 1. Okay, so here you have to keep in mind the steam which is coming from the main steam pipe is the wet steam. Okay, so here you can see that the main steam pipe is connects with the boiler, and from the boiler the wet steam will be come. Okay, now the second component is the control valve. Now what is the function of control valve? Control valve is used to control the flow of steam. Okay, we know that we have to supply some amount of the steam. So some amount will be fixed, means here you have to supply 1 kilogram steam, 2 kilogram steam, 3 kilograms. So the amount of the steam will be fixed, and that amount can be controlled by the control valve. Okay, so here with the help of control valve we can provide 1 kilogram of steam. Okay, now third is the pressure gauge. So with the help of pressure gauge we can measure the pressure of the steam which is entering to the barrel calorimeter. Okay, so this is the function of pressure gauge. Now our fourth component is the sampling tube. Okay, so here the vertical tube which is present inside the barrel calorimeter, it is known as the sampling tube. Now from the sampling tube we can provide the steam to the barrel calorimeter, and this sampling tube is directly connects with our main steam pipe. Okay, now next component is the thermometer. What is the application of thermometer? Thermometer is used to measure the temperature of water, and after the condensation it can measure the how much temperature of water is increased after the condensation. Okay, so basically you have to remember that here thermometer is placed to measure the temperature of water which was placed inside the barrel calorimeter. Next, here there is a one tray is provided and some tiny holes is created inside the tray. That tray is known as the perforated tray. Okay, now the water is kept inside the calorimeter. Okay, and the calorimeter is made from the copper. So you can see here is the copper calorimeter. Now why we have made this as a copper calorimeter? Because the heat conductivity of the copper is excellent. So we can easily measure how much amount of heat is transferred. So we can simply find the dryness fraction. Okay, so here we have made the calorimeter of copper. Next is there is a wooden block is placed. Now the function of the wooden block is to support the copper calorimeter. Okay, now below the wooden box there is a weighing platform. Now what is the application of weighing platform? It will measure the weight of the calorimeter. Now you can understand that there are many components and all the components have different functions. Okay, now how with the help of this calorimeter we can find the dryness fraction. So let us understand the procedure. Okay, so first of all we know that the main steam pipe is connects with the boiler. So from the boiler the wet steam will become, and from the main steam pipe it will goes into the control valve. Okay, so with the help of control valve we will provide particular amount of the steam. Okay, so the mass of the steam will be constant. Okay, now next it will goes to the sampling tube, and in between this we can measure the pressure of the steam. So initially how much with the how much pressure the steam is come, we can measure with the help of pressure. Now from the sampling tube the steam will enters into the bottom perforated tray. Now in the perforated tray there are small tiny holes. Okay, so from that holes the steam will be going outward. Now outside the tray there is a water, you can see. Okay, so the steam will be makes contact with the water. Okay, so what happens, the heat which is stored inside the steam will be gained by the water, so the temperature of the water will be rise. After that the calorimeter is made by the copper. Okay, so finally what happens, water will supply the heat to the copper calorimeter. Okay, so here you have to understand that wet steam is supplies heat to the water, and water will supply the heat to the calorimeter. So here you can understand that the total heat, whatever the amount, okay, if for example we take 100 kilojoule of heat, so the 100 kilojoule of heat was stored into the wet steam. That 100 kilojoule of the heat will be supplied to the water, and then it will supply to the calorimeter. So ultimately some amount of the heat will be taken by water and some amount of the heat will be taken by the copper calorimeter. Okay, after that what happens, the entire amount of the steam which we have supply, if it is 1 kg, then entire 1 kg of the wet steam will be condensed and it will convert into the water. Okay, so this is the simple method how we can measure the dryness fraction with the help of this process. Okay, so here you can understand we have placed thermometer. So before entering the wet steam, we can measure the temperature of water, and after the condensation of steam into the water, we can measure the temperature with the help of thermometer. So we have two value of temperature, before entering the steam and after the condensation of steam. So we can measure the temperature. Second, we can measure the weight, okay, with the help of weighing machine, that before entering the steam, what was the weight, and after entering the steam, what is the weight. So with the help of these two data, we can measure the value of dryness fraction. Okay, so let us calculate the dryness fraction. So this is the procedure that we have already explained. Okay, so it consists of the copper calorimeter, which is placed on the wooden block. There is air space around the calorimeter, which provides the insulation to prevent the heat loss. Now the first step is to measure the weight of the calorimeter with known value of the specific heat of the copper. Okay, we know the specific heat of copper and we know the specific heat of water. Okay, now wet steam is passed in the sampling tube from the main steam pipe, then it will come and it will contact with the water. So automatically the steam will be condensed and the temperature of the water will increase. Okay. Now we are going to calculate the value of dryness fraction with the help of this procedure. Okay, so we can say that the heat which is lost by the steam, that is gained by the water and gained by the calorimeter. Okay, so total amount of heat which is lost by the steam is equals to heat gained by water and calorimeter. Okay, now we know that initially the steam was wet, and for the wet steam we can calculate the enthalpy as HF1 plus XHF1. After the condensation, it is converted into the water, so we can calculate HF2. So here we can write the heat which is lost by the steam is equals to heat which was initially available in the wet steam minus heat available in the water. Okay, so we can say that the heat which is available in the wet steam minus the heat which is available after condensation. So we can say that this is our initial condition number 1 and this is our initial the final condition 2. So we can write that mass of steam in bracket HF1 plus XHFG1, that is our initial condition number 1 when the steam was wet, minus HF2. Here the steam is converted into the water. Okay, so this much amount of the heat the initially steam have. Okay, now this heat is supplied to the water and calorimeter. Now the temperature of water is rise, so we can write the heat gained by the water is equals to mc delta t. So here we have write that mw cpw t2 minus t1. Now here mw is the mass of water, cpw is the specific heat of water, t2 that is the final temperature, and t1 is the initial temperature. Now second is the mass of calorimeter into specific heat of calorimeter into T2 minus T1. So M calorimeter into CPC into T2 minus T1. Here CPC is the specific heat of calorimeter. So with the help of this equation, we can find the value of X. Okay. So here if we get common T2 minus T1, then we can write M calorimeter into CPC plus MW plus CPW. Okay. So from this equation we can measure the value of dryness fraction of the wet steam. Now what are the limitations? So the first limitation is this method is not accurate. Okay. Second thing, here the accuracy is decreased as the temperature difference increases, because the losses are more at the higher temperature difference that I have already discussed. Okay. So the entire procedure is depends on the temperature. Okay, so if the temperature is increased, then the heat loss will be increased and we cannot measure the accurate value with the help of this temperature difference. Okay, so these are the two limitations of the barrel or bucket calorimeter. Okay, now we are going to discuss our second calorimeter, that is the throttling calorimeter. Okay, so let us start. So here there are number of components. First component is the main steam pipe. So the function of main steam pipe is as it is, the it will connect with the boiler and the, it will supply the wet steam to the calorimeter. Now second here we have provide pressure gauge. So the wet steam which is coming from the main steam pipe, its pressure we can measure with the help of pressure gauge. Okay, so our initial pressure will be measured by the pressure gauge. Now second, here we have provided the throttle valve. Okay, now what is the function of this throttle valve and what is the meaning of throttling process, that we will discuss later. Okay, but here you have to understand that before the throttle valve there is a pressure P1 and after the throttle valve there is a pressure P2. Okay, so in the throttling process the pressure will be changed. Now what is the throttling process, that we will discuss later. Okay, then what happens, this steam is comes into the throttling calorimeter. Okay, now in the throttling calorimeter the steam will be circulated. Okay, here in the calorimeter we have provided water and the thermometer. So when the steam is circulated inside the calorimeter, the temperature of the water will be rise. So with the help of the thermometer we can measure the temperature of the initial condition and of the final condition. Now after that we have provided here the manometer. Now what is the function of this manometer? Manometer is used to measure the pressure. Okay, so after throttling what is the amount of pressure, that we can measure with the help of this manometer. Okay, now we are going to understand what is the meaning of throttling process. Okay, so in the throttling process the enthalpy will remains constant. Okay, so before the throttling and after the throttling the enthalpy will remains constant. Now in the throttling process what happens, we are passing the stream from the small passage. Okay, so this is a simple throttling process. Now when we are passing the steam from the small passage, what happens, the enthalpy will remains constant but the pressure will decrease. Okay, so we can say that here the initially the pressure was P1, we can measure with the pressure gauge. Okay, after throttling what happens, the pressure is reduced. Now we know that the when the pressure is reduced the and the temperature will remains constant. Okay, during the throttling process what happens, the enthalpy will remains constant. Due to the enthalpy we know that enthalpy is function of temperature, so that the temperature will also remains constant. Okay, so enthalpy and temperature will remains constant, so H1 equals to H2 and P1, T1 equals to T2 we can write. But here the pressure will reduce. Now with the reduction in the pressure what happens, the initially there was the wet steam. Now when we reduce the pressure of the wet steam, it will automatically converts into the superheated steam. That is the main thing you have to remember, that before the throttling there was a wet steam, after the throttling the steam is converted into the superheating state. Okay, so again I am repeating, what is the throttling process and why we have provided this throttling valve. In the throttling process enthalpy is remains constant, temperature is remains constant but pressure is reduced. Now before the throttling process there was a wet steam present. Okay, after throttling what happens, this wet steam is converted into the superheating steam. Why it is converted into the superheating steam? Because here we have reduced the pressure. So if the pressure is reduced then wet steam will be converted into the superheated steam. Okay, now we can say that the from the main steam pipe the wet steam is come and the pressure of wet steam we can measure with the help of this pressure gauge. After the throttling the wet steam is converted into the superheating steam and the pressure of superheating steam we can measure with the help of this manometer. Okay, so now these are the function of all the components. Now what is the procedure? Okay, so ultimately our aim is to find the dryness fraction. Okay, so how we can measure the dryness fraction with the throttling calorimeter. So let us discuss the procedure. So from the main steam pipe the steam is come, then it will throttle and it will convert into the superheating steam. Then this superheating steam will be circulated inside the calorimeter. So the energy or the heat which was available in the superheating steam will be supplied to the water, and after that the temperature of water will be rise, and the increase of temperature we can measure with the help of this thermometer. Okay, and with the help of this manometer we can measure the pressure of the superheating steam. Okay, so here all the description is given. Okay, so how the steam is converted into the superheated steam. Okay, now we are going to calculate the dryness fraction, that is our main aim. So here we can write that the enthalpy before throttling is equals to enthalpy after throttling, because we know that in the throttling process the enthalpy will remains constant. Okay, so enthalpy before throttling, this is the enthalpy of wet steam. Enthalpy after throttling, after throttling it is converted into the superheating steam. So we can write here the enthalpy of superheating steam. Okay, so these are the equations. So enthalpy of the wet steam, this is our initial condition number 1. So we can write here enthalpy of wet steam is equals to HF1 plus XHFG1. Okay, now second is the enthalpy of superheated steam. So the enthalpy of superheated steam we can write as HG2 plus CPS T superheated minus T saturated. So with the help of this equation we can find the value of X. Okay, now what are the limitations? So the first limitation is this calorimeter is suitable for the higher value of the dryness fraction. Okay, so if the dryness fraction is 0.5 or 0.6, then we cannot measure with the help of this calorimeter. Why? Because here the condition is that you have to convert wet steam into the superheating steam. Now if the value of dryness fraction is about 0.8 or 0.9, then and then only we can convert it from the wet steam to the superheating steam by reducing the pressure. Okay, but if there are more number of water molecules present and if the dryness fraction is about 0.5 or 0.6, then we cannot convert the entire water into the superheating condition by reducing the pressure. Okay, so the limitation of this throttling calorimeter is that this calorimeter is useful for only measuring the higher value of the dryness fraction. Okay, so in this lecture we have discussed about the two calorimeter. One is the barrel calorimeter and second is the throttling calorimeter. Both have some limitations. Okay, in our next lecture we will discuss about some other calorimeters. Okay, so this is the end of our lecture. Thank you for today.